Today I'm going to break down exactly how I feed my spiderlings and baby scorpions, and we're starting right now. Now, I've got a lot of comments and more than a few messages from people asking me to really go in depth and explain how I feed my spiderlings and my baby scorpions, or scorplings is what we're going to call them. That's a thing, right? I'm pretty sure that's a thing. So in this video, I'm going to be explaining exactly what type of prey I use, how I feed them, and how often I feed them, and pretty much anything concerning feeding of very small spiders and scorpions. Welcome back to the Tarantula Collective. My name is Richard, and if this is your first time here, you're new to the channel, be sure to hit that subscribe button so you don't miss any of the new videos that I upload, especially if you're interested in tarantula, scorpions, or all pets exotic. So to really go in depth on how I'm feeding my spiderlings, we're gonna need to head back here to this table. It'll make it a lot easier. I can show you exactly how I do it. So let's go back there, come on. All right, we are here at the tarantula table, and first off, we're just gonna discuss what is a spiderling. Now, for me, it's just one of those things that's kind of hard to describe, but you know it when you see it. But really, it kind of depends on the species. I mean, kind of my rule of thumb is like an inch or smaller, but there are some tarantulas like Theraphosa species that I would consider a spiderling in that kind of genus to be much larger than an inch. And there are dwarf species and stuff that maybe they could be an inch and not technically a spiderling anymore, because they only grow to like 2, 2.5 inches or maybe 3 inches. But kind of what I use to determine the difference between a spiderling and a juvenile is just the appearance. When they're kind of that like tannish, brownish, grayish color, they don't really have that adult coloration yet, I still consider those spiderlings. But really, it's gonna depend on what species of tarantula we're talking about. So a question that I get asked a lot is, how often should you feed your spiderlings? In my videos, I usually say I feed them twice a week, and that's really just more of a guideline than a hard and fast rule. I like to check on my spiderlings and attempt to feed them every 3 or 4 days. But you can do it as little as maybe once a week. Spiderlings are very vulnerable, very fragile at that size. So I like to check on them at least twice a week, maybe even 3 times a week, just make sure they're doing okay. And because I am feeding them twice a week, doesn't mean I'm actually giving them prey or that they're eating. If they look like they're in pre-molt or they're extremely plump, then I'll skip feeding them that time. But it gives me an opportunity to check on the moisture in their enclosure, see if they need some water, remove any molts or dead prey that may be left in there. Just general maintenance and just kind of keeping an eye on them. Now, personally, I don't feed my slings or baby scorpions any prey that's more than 2/3 the size of their body. And I'm not taking into consideration leg span here, just like the carapace and the abdomen. I try to feed them prey that's smaller than they are, definitely nothing larger than they are. And sometimes with those very small slings, it can be difficult finding size-appropriate prey. You might not have access to a lot of the things we'll be discussing here. Your pet shop may only have some crickets, and they're all large. But that's okay, you can still get a viable food source from them. So let's talk about what type of prey is best for spiderlings. Now, personally, something I use a lot for my smallest spiderlings are flightless fruit flies. Now, they get a pretty bad rap in the hobby. A lot of people hate using them, and it's understandable. They jump around a lot. They're very small. They can escape through your ventilation holes and screen mesh, and they're a pain in the butt. But there are some ways that you can use them effectively and not make a big mess, and we'll go over that in just a second. Also, I like mealworms. They're great for your larger spiderlings and juveniles, and they even will work for your smallest slings because they're very simple to cut up. And then this one I get asked about a lot, and these are just confused flower beetles. Now, I've never seen these for sale at a pet store, but I don't have very many exotic pet stores around me. This colony I purchased off some stranger on eBay, and I've had it for well over a year. It's still doing very well and supplying plenty of food. Now, some of my spiderlings won't touch the beetles themselves, but the colony has a lot of larvae in there as well, kind of these white-looking worms. So I'll just take those out and drop them on the web, and they'll eat them no problem. And then, of course, there are pinhead crickets, or just very small crickets. Sometimes those can be difficult to find at your local pet store. They might have like small, medium, and large, but nothing that's that small, like the pinhead variety. Now, you can order those online. There's plenty of places that will sell them and ship them straight to your door. If you breed crickets, you'll have plenty of those. And of course, you've got roaches, whether they're red runners or dubias or, you know, whatever roach you're using, you can use the nymphs of those. Mainly, it's just the red runner nymphs that you can use for the smallest spiderlings, but dubia nymphs will also work, especially if you just cut them in half. Now, most of my spiderlings are very shy, so even if they're out on the surface when I take the lid off the enclosure, when I drop in prey, they'll run and hide. Very rarely do I actually see them take anything down, but sometimes you do. What I do in those situations is I just leave that prey in there overnight, usually about 24 hours. I'll check in on him the next day, and anybody that didn't eat, I'll remove that live prey. You don't want to leave live prey in the enclosure, especially if the tarantula might be in pre-molt. When spiderlings molt, they're very vulnerable, and a cricket or worm could see that as an opportunity to attack and even try to eat your sling. So you don't want your prey attacking your spiderlings, so always remove any uneaten prey. Something else you could do, which what I do a lot, is I'll smash the head of the prey and then just throw it down on their webbing or, you know, on the surface of the enclosure. That way the prey's not moving around a whole lot, but it is kind of twitching, so it'll attract or kind of initiate that feeding response from the spider. And you don't have to worry about it having a working mandible that could like bite a leg off of your sling. The baby scorpions have been a little different. Some species will like pounce on the prey as soon as it hits the ground. Others will run and hide, but I'll check in on them a couple hours later and they're munching down. So I try not to worry too much if my spiderling or baby scorpion doesn't eat right away, because I know if I just give them some space and give them a little bit of time, they'll eat no problem. Now, when they're approaching molt, it's pretty easy to tell. And while they're in pre-molt, they're probably not going to eat at all. And pre-molt could last for a few days to months. So you got to be patient and just kind of keep an eye on the situation. But you can tell a spiderling is in pre-molt because its abdomen will be very plump and it'll have a dark, shiny spot. You can kind of see the hair or like the exoskeleton underneath their current exoskeleton really starting to grow out. So when it's dark and shiny, you know that it's in pre-molt or is pretty close to being in pre-molt. And once it's in that stage, there's not much you can do. It could molt in a few days or a few weeks or even a few months. Some of my Afanus pilma species have been in pre-molt for nearly 6 months as spiderlings. There's nothing you can do to hurry up that situation. You just gotta wait. Now, as far as after a molt, how soon should you feed your spiderling? I usually wait about 48 hours personally, but I've been told by a couple of like well-known big breeders and dealers of tarantulas that they feed theirs 24 hours after a molt. Spiderlings get a lot of their moisture requirement from eating prey, and the process of molting is, you know, very intensive. They exert a lot of energy, so usually when they're done, they're hungry and thirsty. So as long as the tarantula is hardened up, you know, its fangs are hard and it can, you know, attack prey without damaging itself, then you can go ahead and feed it. So if you want to do 24 hours after they molt, you should be okay, according to these people that know a whole lot more about this than I do. Personally though, I usually wait 48 hours, and it's not just because I want to wait 48 hours. You know, I only check on them every 2 or 3 days, so sometimes they'll molt right after I check on them and I won't even notice it for a couple of days. Now I've got like 10 or 11 different spiderlings and squirplings here on the table. Different sizes, different species, they're in different types of enclosures. And I'm just gonna walk through how I feed them, what kind of prey I use, how I prepare that prey. Maybe we'll get some of them actually feeding on camera, but I highly doubt it. At the very least, I'm gonna be able to show you how I feed my spiderlings. I know that's like a very stressful part, especially for new keepers. They're really unsure about how to feed their spiderlings, and I would just really want to kind of alleviate that worry for you, show exactly how I do it. But there are a lot of different ways to feed tarantulas, so this is not by any means the end-all be-all. Whatever works for you, whatever works for your spiderlings and scorpions is what you should do. All right, first up, I'm going to feed my little baby. It's like a second instar striped devil scorpion. It's very small. It's kind of difficult sometimes to find prey that it will eat because it doesn't want to have anything to do with the confused flower beetles. So what I like to use, especially for these tiny little squirplings or my smallest spiderlings, are flightless fruit flies. Now, I just pick those up at the local pet store. They're inexpensive. There's a little trick that you can use that will make them a lot easier to manage. Essentially what I do is I take the little container of flightless fruit flies, I knock them out into a clear plastic container with a lid. So we'll go ahead and do that now. All right, I got a good amount in there. Now these things can't fly, but they do jump and they can climb the side of plastic. And if you don't get the lid on there right away, they're gonna jump out and be jumping all over your house. I've got probably a couple dozen in here. Now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take this and put it in my refrigerator. Now you'll need to leave them in there for anywhere between like 5 to 15 minutes. It kind of depends on, I guess, how cold your refrigerator is. So just check on them every 5 minutes. And when they start getting very lethargic, almost look like they're barely moving at all, that's when you wanna take them out. If you leave them in too long, they're probably gonna die. And if you don't put them in there long enough, then they're still gonna be jumping around and acting crazy. I can just drop 2 or 3 of them inside the enclosure and it's not a hassle. Only issue is you gotta work fast, because once they start warming up, they get a lot more active. In which case, all you gotta do is just put the lid back on, stick them in your fridge another 5 minutes or so, and start the process all over again. So I'm gonna go do that right now. I'll be right back. All right, the flies are in the fridge, so while we're waiting on them to cool down, we'll move on to the next type of prey. Now, before we get started feeding, there's just a few things you're gonna need. These are just some like tools that I like to use when I'm feeding my spiderlings. First off is some forceps or tongs, whatever you call them. The finer the tongs, the better. You also need a knife or a blade, something to cut up prey with. And I like using like a little cutting board or like a piece of wood or something that's not gonna damage your blade. All right, so first up, we're gonna feed one of my spiderlings just a tiny pinhead cricket. So the first thing I do before I feed my tarantulas is check their water. Not all of my slings have water dishes though. Some of them I just spray water on the side of the enclosure or on their webbing. And we're just gonna grab one little tiny cricket. Now when I am choosing the cricket, again, I try to find one that's no larger than the body of the tarantula. That's the carapace and the abdomen. Now, since it's hiding and kind of freaked out, it's not gonna feed, but I'm gonna just leave that in there and I'm gonna check on it tomorrow, see if the prey had been eaten. I don't think I've ever actually seen that sling eat, but I mean, it's fat and it's growing, so I know that it's eaten. Now, one thing you can do if you're worried your spiderling's not eating is to just crush the head of the cricket or somehow immobilize it so the cricket's not moving around a whole lot and it'll stay in that location, but still kind of be twitching. That way, when you check in on it, you don't have to worry that maybe the cricket is hiding down in the burrow or something. You know that it's not moving from that spot, so if it's gone, that means a tarantula ate it. Now we're gonna try the same thing. We're gonna feed one of these small crickets to one of my baby scorpions. This is the Hatteras spatix. It's the black-haired, hairy scorpion. All right, up next, I have a D-Diamond tenesis that was sent to me from Alex over at Tarantula Haven. He sent me a package. I think it was like 4 or 5 of them in there. It looks like it could eat. What I'm gonna do this time is feed it some of these larvae. Quick little tip, whenever you're preparing your prey for your sling, you know, always make sure that lid is on there and it's on there well. Don't open it up until you're ready to put in some water and ready to drop in the prey. Take this little larva and set it right there on its webbing. Now as it fights around and squirms, you know, the tarantula is gonna sense that and it'll come up here and snatch it up. What I do need to do though is get those flightless fruit flies out of the fridge. So just give me a second, I'll be right back. All right, we got them and they're not moving, which is a good sign. So as you can see, there's a few of them still moving in there, but for the most part, they're all kind of in this like hibernation state. So what we're gonna do is we're just gonna slowly dump a few of them out into some of these small enclosures before, you know, they are really awake. And so first off, we're going to drop a few in here with my baby striped devil scorpion. Doesn't look like he's gonna eat on camera for us, but didn't really expect that. But we'll go ahead and put the lid on there and let it be. Now the next tarantula I'm gonna give some of these flightless fruit flies to is my other Brachypelma smithii. This one is not in pre-molt, looks like it could take another meal, so we're just gonna dump a few of those in there. Now one of the major downsides to the flightless fruit flies is that all these little holes on the side, I mean, maybe not in this enclosure because these are pretty tiny holes, but in some of your larger spiderling enclosures, they can just crawl right out of the vent. So if the tarantula doesn't eat them by the time they're fully up and moving and exploring, more than likely they're gonna crawl right out. So it's something you gotta keep in mind when you're using those. And finally, we're gonna do some of the mealworms. I get the small mealworms at the local pet store. Most of the time, those will be fine for your larger slings. But if you're feeding a smaller spiderling, you're gonna need to chop them up a little bit. This also applies to crickets. If you can only get large crickets, you know, you can chop those up as well. But what I'm doing here is I got a little mealworm. You know, it's probably, I don't know, an inch long. I'm gonna chop this up into like 2 or 3 pieces to about the size of this, you know, a little bit smaller than the sling, and drop that in there. Now, spiderlings are scavenger feeders. You know, they do that naturally, you know, in the wild. So if you just drop some food in there, you know, they'll notice it and they'll come up and they'll eat it. And if they don't, then you just pull that out before it starts rotting and getting nasty, throw it away and try again in 3 or 4 days. Now, one thing I do suggest if you're gonna be chopping up mealworms or crickets or, you know, roaches, whatever it is, just kind of be humane. Smash their head first. That way they at least have like a quick, painless death. They don't have to like sit there as you're chopping them up being fully conscious of that. And even after, you know, you've smashed their head, they'll still kind of squirm around for a few minutes. Now, one thing I don't like to do is to drop food down into their burrow. And that's mainly because if they don't eat, then I gotta like dig down in there and pull it out before it starts rotting and getting nasty. And it also makes it very difficult to tell if they even ate at all. It'll know that there's something up there on the surface. And if they're hungry, they'll come up and eat. And if not, just pull it out of there. So don't feed it anything larger than the tarantula itself. Pre-kill the prey if necessary, because they will scavenge feed. Check on them once or twice a week. Make sure they got plenty of moisture and they're ready to eat. Remove any kind of uneaten prey or boluses or molts or, you know, anything that doesn't belong in there. Pull it out, keep it clean. Just spot clean it. You don't need to like change a substrate or anything like that. If you want to see more videos I've made on taking care of spiderlings, just check out this playlist right here. And if you want to catch up on all my past care and husbandry videos, just check out this playlist right here. As always, I appreciate you watching. Subscribe if you want to see more. Thanks for buying Tarantula Collective merchandise, and I will see you next Tuesday.